I'm ready whenever you guys are.
This week on the Stogie Geek Show, we interview Gabriel Alvarez from Maya Silva Cigars. We're going to smoke some of his cigars and smoke some of the ones that he sent up. And the reviews are very, very positive at this point, so make sure you pay attention during that segment. We're going to do something on Sinatra to celebrate his 100th birthday, which is Saturday in our Debonair Ideal segment. And in the Stogies of the Week, we're going to talk about all kinds of different cigars. We're going to delve again into a little bit into flavored cigars and talk about a lot of different sticks. It's all that and more, so stay tuned. Every new blend borrows from the past, and the Saga Blend number 7, it is the perfect combination of timeless knowledge of traditional tobaccos and the newer balance that today's cigar enthusiasts come to expect and love in a fine cigar. Leveraging 6 generations of experience and tradition of the Reyes family, the Saga Blend number 7 delivers a unique, full-flavored, medium-bodied cigar. The cigar is highlighted by a Brazilian wrapper over a blend of Central American and Dominican tobacco. Available in 3 sizes at an affordable price, the Saga Blend No. 7 is sure to please and bring together past and present. From the makers of the number one cigar in the U.S. in 2013, the Aging Room Quattro F55 comes yet another highly rated cigar, the Aging Room Bin No. 1. The Aging Room Bin No. 1 is a full-bodied Dominican cigar with some of the world's oldest tobacco on the market today. From the harvest of 1997, 98, and 99. The Aging Room Bin No. 1 starts out smooth and builds up in strength and flavor until it reaches its full potential. The Aging Room Bin No. 1 is for the true cigar connoisseur, looking for a sophisticated smoking experience with balance, complexity, and character. Aging Room Cigars. Blending is in our DNA. M-Bombay Cigars represent the most admired cigar culture of Cuba. They select the best of the best quality tobacco to use in the aging process. M-Bombay cigars are then rolled in Costa Rica by some of the most experienced cigar rollers, giving it a unique smoking experience. The band portrays the detailed and artistic nature of our small industry. Try the M-Bombay Casera, M-Bombay Mora, and the recently released M-Bombay Habano. M-Bombay cigars, where the cigar is a way of life. Havana Cigar Club, located in Warwick, Rhode Island, is a great place to enjoy a drink and a cigar. Stogie Geeks listeners can find a $5 off coupon on our website by clicking the HCC logo. Welcome, everyone, to the Stogie Geek Show. This is episode 167 for December 10th, 2015. I am, of course, very excited to be here tonight to tell you all everything about cigars and everything that's happened in the last week, all the cigars we've been smoking. And, of course, interview our fabulous guest for this evening. Mr. Will Cooper is on the lines via Skype. Welcome, Will.
Hey, Paul. How's it going today?
Dude, it's going fantastic. I made myself an old-fashioned. I lit up this fabulous cigar. I mean, if I were to complain, dude, no one would listen. So.
No. I've lit up the Florida Silver Maduro, which...
Me too.
I'm going to even go out on this, and we're going to get to our guests in it. This is one of the best Maduros to come out of Honduras in a while.
You know, it was interesting. I was reading a little bit about the blend, and I was I continue to be amazed as to the different components and just how they meld together in this cigar.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, there are, just like any other country, right? There are cigars from Honduras that have Honduran tobacco in it that I like. There are some that I don't like as much. But Flor de Silva, just, it's unbelievable the way they make cigars with that Honduran tobacco. And, you know, in the U.S., a lot of people are like, I haven't really heard of them, or maybe someone gifted me one because they're very popular. In Europe, as is the game of Ask Grabby Grabby. It's just a wonderful opportunity to smoke more of these cigars and have their representative on the lines via Skype, Mr. Gabriel Alvarez. Welcome back to the show.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me on again.
Yes, Gabriel, it's very nice to have you back on the show. I I feel like we've kept in constant contact via Facebook, and I thank you for that. I love your Facebook feed. I love Grace's Facebook feed. You guys are very you're very real and transparent on Facebook, which we appreciate.
Wow.
And now I see you post about your kids on Facebook as well. We seem to share a lot in common, and I think we have kids around the same age, so we have the same joy, the same struggles of raising children, right?
I had a nice little, I guess every parent has to go through this. Who hasn't dealt with a lice infestation?
Oh, that's awful. No. Oh. That's awful.
It happens. It happens. It's all you gotta say.
And apparently now there's clinics dedicated to lice removal.
You know, I can see that flourishing as a business. Absolutely.
Oh, I remember. I mean, what is it? That shampoo? That horrible shampoo? That horrible shampoo you used to have to use.
It smells like the fumigator just passed by the house. You know.
Yeah, it is nothing good about it.
No, it's great. I'm so glad to have met you both, and friended you both, you know that we're all real people, right? At the end of the day, we deal with the similar kind of things. You know, kids getting lice and things like that. We're fortunate enough here tonight to be sitting around and smoking Flor de Selva cigars, which is great.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, Gabriel, when did the Maduro wrapped Flor de Selvas first come on the market?
All right. Initially, we released the Maduro, I want to say maybe like 7 or 8 years ago for the European market, one size. And honestly, the name just slipped my mind. It wasn't the Robusto or anything like that. It wasn't your typical Vitola name. It was a special name for the Flor de Selva line as a, I can't say it was limited edition, but it was, I guess it was doing a trial run in the European market to see how it would go off.
Mm-hmm.
And it worked. And then it went silent for a couple of years. And after that, when Maya introduced the cigars here in the United States, she introduced the Robusto Maduro, and as well as the rest of the collection for Flor de Selva Natural with the Connecticut, the Cumpai line, and the Via Zamorano line.
Hey, Gabriel, there's like a dinging noise. Is that coming from your?
I get the stupid iMessages on my laptop too, and someone's family's screaming.
Someone's messaging you, dude.
I'm looking on my machine to see if it was that.
Yeah.
They're asking me for brown sugar. They're asking my wife, but we're in a stupid group message, and they take over.
All those group messages are the death of me.
I know.
I was able to turn it off. So,
thank you.
So basically, you guys with those headphones, you got to be loving that thing.
Yes. Yes.
So when she introduced the Robusto line, it took off fairly well here in the United States, and she wanted to expand on that. So the second year at IPCPR here, which was 14, the year that I came on board, but right after IPCPR, she introduced the number 15 Maduro and the Tempo Maduro, which Will is a fan of.
Yep, I'm smoking the Tempo at you now.
Yep, me too.
And then,
you're smoking a Toro.
Yeah, I'm smoking the 15. I think Paul's smoking the Toro.
Yes.
Will, what are you smoking, the Tempo?
I'm smoking the Tempo, the 60.
Oh, you're smoking the 60. I'm smoking the Toro.
Yeah.
So we're all smoking something different. And in the Maduro collection. And this year we expanded. And I, talking with Maya and explaining to her how the American market is, it was odd. And a lot of questions around, like through my travels and everything else. Why didn't we have a Toro in our portfolio? And I told them, and I explained to everybody, this was a European company. When I came on board, we condensed the portfolio. We eliminated some of the Vitolas that aren't really very popular. They're great cigars, great Vitolas. But for that mass market approach that we're doing, it's better to condense the portfolio, introduce it, and then later on expand it again with maybe regional exclusives and stuff like that with these special sizes, which I'm using for the ones that I discontinued here in the States. We're using for events and things like that for a special added value type of thing. When you visit one of our events, you're gonna get a cigar that's really not for sale.
Gabriel, what was it? Can you do you have any like insight into what it was like to release a Maduro cigar into the European market, who is very much in tune with Cuban cigars, of which not too many of those are Maduro in their history?
Well, I don't know too much about the European market. I've only been into Europe once. I visited our headquarters over there in June, late June, early July. I was over there for our 20th anniversary party. And what I did notice was that our Cumpai line, we feature a Maduro here. We'll experience that Cumpai Maduro, the Volcan Maduro.
Oh, my goodness.
That
I never thought... Go ahead, Gabriel. I'll let you...
That by far is the strongest cigar we make. And we haven't done a full rollout of that cigar. The people that carry, the stores that carry the Cumpai line, they bring it in because it's a 5x60, full body, full flavored cigar. This is the strongest thing we make, 100% Nicaraguan puro, as strong as it comes, at least for our line. And we don't sell that in Europe. It was something that Maya tried here. It took off within the clients that the company had right when we started, and it's been very well received. So we don't have that over there because of the strength of the cigar. It's too strong. It won't sell. But with the Flor de Selva being – I consider Flor de Selva, and you guys, please correct me if I'm wrong, but I consider Flor de Selva Maduros to be medium-bodied, full flavor.
No, I would agree with that. I would also add, Gabriel, that the Flor de Selva in this Maduro wrapper has this saltiness component.
Yep.
That just it adds such an awesome dimension to the flavor profile. Really keeps you engaged with the cigar. Really coats your palate nicely. And I love that about this. The only other brand, and I'm going to make a comparison, but the other brand that I really get that saltiness from is from Davidoff. Really has that saltiness component in their flavor profile, and I really got this from completely different tobaccos. I mean, this is a Honduran Maduro wrapper with a Matafina binder, and then different fillers from Honduras. Correct? Did I get the blend right?
Yeah, it's almost a puro except for the binder. We went with a Brazilian
binder, yeah. But that saltiness components really helps balance out all those other flavors that are going on in the cigar, and I like that a lot. And you're smiling because you got that when you smoked this cigar.
Like a dark chocolate almost.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Or when you eat salted chocolate, if anybody's eating salted chocolate, where they have the little pieces of salt on top of it, and it just contrasts so much between the natural sweetness that the wrapper gives. And it keeps your palate entertained as you're smoking it, and then all the nuances that come as you're smoking the cigar just open up your palate, and you're tasting so many different things at the same time that it's kind of hard to pinpoint it. And I had never never thought about it as saltiness, and now that you bring it up, and it's like, yes, I agree 100% because that is definitely. That note, that saltiness is definitely that note that I was trying to describe before, and I couldn't, and I would say bittersweet almost.
Yep. Paul, you nailed it too. I didn't think of that either.
The Maduro, I don't get a bitterness component, and that's not always a bad thing either. We talk about doing different blending seminars, right? We talk about salty, bitter, sweet, sour, and savory, right, as being the flavor components. And this cigar really embodies that balance between salty and sweet. And for me, that really allows me, when something has that saltiness and sweetness, as this cigar does, it lets me pair it. And it's interesting because I paired it with coffee earlier today, and I finally got a hold of some really good coffee here in the studio. Wonderful Sumatran blend of coffee. It paired so well with that coffee. Now, I'm pairing it with an old-fashioned with bourbon, which has a lot of sweetness in it as well, and it pairs so well with that. And that versatility, it speaks volumes into the rating, right? And a lot of people rate their cigars in different ways, and you know, all the more power to them. But, you know, I call this cigar box-worthy because if I'm going to have a whole box of cigars in my humidor, I'm going to want to – I don't want to be limited as to what when I smoke them and what I pair with them when I smoke them. So that box-worthy rating speaks volumes. As you compare this with coffee, you compare this with an old-fashioned, and get so much flavor dimension out of it because of that salty and sweetness component.
I'm drinking scotch, and it's
yeah. No, that's a great pairing as well.
Yeah. And
to me, I'll smoke the Maduro with – I'd rather smoke the Connecticut – but the Maduro still plays well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you're right. It's medium-bodied. It's not too strong, so I can smoke it earlier in the day with a cup of coffee and not be overwhelmed with strength either.
This Maduro, too, there's a lot of Maduros out there that I hate to be like it, but a lot of them taste the same.
Mm.
And this is just it's Maduro, but it's, you know, you mentioned some of the nuances that really make this a different cigar. And it really wowed me. There's been a lot of good Maduros this year. I think it's been a good year for the Maduro. That Toro, that whole blend came together. We have an expression, Gabriel, bell of the ball, which I think is the best size. And I've smoked all three sizes of the Maduro, and they're great. But that Toro just kind of goes to another level with that.
I have to agree with you because I was in love with the number 15, which I'm smoking now, which is our Torpedo. And people ask, why do you call it the number 15? It was a cigar that we released portfolio-wise at our 15th anniversary. We didn't have a Torpedo back then. We had Pyramids. We had Bellicosos at one point. We never really had a Torpedo. And Maya released it line-wide on our 15th anniversary for the Flor de Cepa Connecticut, the Cumbaya, and the Villa Zamorano. And then when she launched the Flor de Cepa Maduro, 2 years ago, she expanded on the line there. She added the 15 Vitola as well. And to me, that was my favorite till the Toro came out.
Hmm. Yeah, because I like the – I may have smoked the Bellicoso in the natural, and I really like that cigar as well. In fact, I think you can go in the Stogie Geeks archive and see a very favorable rating for that cigar as well. And I very much like the natural wrapper as well. I find that there's this sweetness that kind of comes and goes throughout that cigar that really keeps your attention, which I really appreciate as well. And I smoked that one too. Gabriel, you were very kind and sent us a lot of different cigars, a lot of which we're going to give away on the show, a lot of which I've smoked and have reviewed for the show, some of which I've given to some of our trusted advisors, who I hope at this point, a couple of guys showed up tonight and I handed them the Toro in the Maduro and they're smoking it now. So we'll get their take on it. I'm pretty hopeful that they're very confident, actually, that they're going to really love this cigar. And I can't wait to hear their impressions of it as well. So I wanted to thank you for that. And Gabriel, can you talk a little bit about the blend specifically that goes in this Maduro? And where are the different places in Honduras, and then how does that Brazilian Matafina kind of play into it?
Well, when I wasn't around for original blending on the Maduro Connecticut, I mean on the Maduro line,
mm-hmm.
At all. This was all done prior to me coming on board with the company. And in talking to Maya, she likes to stay true to her land. She's part Honduran, part French, and she has a huge fondness for her country of Honduras. And her main purpose of creating the Flor de Cepa line was to create an economy in that country 20 years ago and be able to offer something to the French market, to the Parisians and those guys over there that was something completely different than what they were normally smoking, which was the Cubans. You know, we know how strong the Cubans are in the European market because of the embargo here and that forbidden fruit type of thing for the people here, which I can't wait for it to open up so they can realize that forbidden fruit was a spoiled apple, but that's another topic. But they're so used to the smokes that the Cubans were making 20 years ago that Maya wanted to do something different for them. And when it came to the Maduro collection, as she was expanding the lines, she tried to stay as true to it as possible to do another puro from Honduras. And it just wasn't working. And in one of the blending sessions that they were sitting at with Plasencia, they came across some Brazilian Matafina that wasn't wrapper grade, but it was definitely binder grade. And they tried it. They tried it individually, and it was just an incredible flavor that was coming out of it. And when just imagining what it would do to the blend, when they tried it out, it was like a home run because it gave just that point of strength that they were looking for into the Maduro collection. And then as far as the rest of the blend, I'll learn more now in January. I'm going for the second time to our factories in January for our sales meetings, and we're taking our sales reps over there so they can experience everything hands-on and learn the lines with the true history and everything right there where it started. But every tobacco that we use is sourced through Plasencia. And, I mean, you're talking about the largest grower in Honduras and probably the world when it comes to diversity in regions where they grow their tobaccos from. And these guys, we have access to some incredible grade A tobacco. And that's where I like to say that we stand apart. And the people ask me, but you're a new cigar, you're a boutique company, why are you so expensive? And it's like, we're not expensive. When you realize the amount of money that we put into making our cigars because of the type of tobacco that we buy from one source. We don't switch it out. We don't shop around. We buy one source. Once we have the blends done, we strive to stay true to those blends for the consistency aspect of the company.
Yeah, Gabriel, actually, I was to the Plasencia Farms earlier this year, and I got to go under the cheesecloth, which was really cool, where they were growing the Connecticut Shade stuff. And there, yeah, there's a massive farms out down there.
See the size of the cheese?
Oh, yeah.
It's like a blanket.
It's like a blank. Yeah, this thing is like, Paul, you walk under the cheese, it's like nothing you've ever seen.
It's like a gigantic tent, right?
I mean, but it goes back and back. You walk back and back, and it just never ends, it seems like, yeah.
Acres and acres of this cheesecloth just on stilts all the way across, covering acres and acres and acres of land with all this tobacco growing under it.
And so, Gabriel, the Plasencia Farms, are they, when they grow your Connecticut wrapper, is that in Ecuador or is that in Honduras? Where is that wrapper being grown?
Honduras. Originally, started with the Ecuadorian Connecticut.
Mm-hmm.
The company did start using because there was no Connecticut seed being grown in Honduras.
Mm-hmm.
And Maya fought so much to be able to make a puro straight from her land that with Plasencia, they tested it out. They tested a few crops, and they noticed the size of the leaves that were coming out in Honduras, the flavor that was coming out, and it was something different. And Plasencia just went nuts. I mean, he started growing Connecticut and Connecticut and Connecticut. And by no means is the Connecticut that Plasencia grows only for us. There's a lot of other manufacturers
mm-hmm.
that use that same Connecticut. But when we get all the grade A tobacco from the Connecticut assortment, we regrade those leaves. We try to stay as flawless as possible, as minimal veins as possible, and we regrade it as Flor de Selva wrapper. And if you go into Plasencia's sorting facilities where they have all the pacas, which is the bales of tobacco already packaged up, you'll find some bales that are marked Flor de Selva because we've already resorted everything, given Plasencia back the tobacco that we don't consider to be Flor de Selva quality, and we use our tobacco. That becomes our tobacco at that point because we buy it from him.
Yeah, it's interesting. The Connecticut is a fantastic cigar, in my opinion. I think it has some of that bitter component, which I think is important to keep your attention, right? And coffee can sometimes have that bitter component as well. But what I noticed throughout that Connecticut in the Toro that you sent me, and certainly in other sizes as well, is that sweetness. And that sweetness makes like a wave, right? Like it's almost like, you know, it kind of comes and goes and presents itself in different ways as you smoke it, which really helps hold your attention. And I really liked the Connecticut, and I'm impressed that that's a Honduran grown Connecticut seed in shade grown Honduran tobacco, right? That's really cool.
Gabriel, what would you say? I mean, you've smoked a lot of cigars. What would you say that Honduran shade wrapper brings different than you see maybe from the Ecuadorian Connecticut's?
I think it's a hardier wrapper. It's a thicker wrapper.
That's a good point.
The bitterness isn't as pronounced as you would find with an Ecuadorian Connecticut. You don't have to blend so much as to kill that bitterness. And I don't know if maybe that's because of the thickness in the wrapper and not being so like onion skin type. I mean, I've had a cigar fall, one of our Connecticut's fall, and it would crack. I mean, I've had it fall and crack, but sometimes it doesn't. And to me, that goes into the grade of that wrapper that we're using. And the keeping that wrapper a little bit thicker and thick enough to just be able to accept a small hit or something like that, that it won't crack on you.
It's interesting you say that, Gabriel. What I found with both of the you sent us the Toro in the Maduro and the natural wrappers. The smoking time on this Toro is probably at least a half an hour to 45 minutes longer than your typical Toro. I'm wondering if that's, you know, a component of the way you've blended, of course, a lot of the fillers, but having that wrapper be a little thicker, it tends to burn slower. And I get a lot more smoking time out of the Flor de Silva cigars than I do in other cigars in a similar size.
Okay. One thing you will not find in our cigars on a typical basis, I want to say we're not perfect. Everything's handmade. But for the majority, 98% is what we strive for. You're not going to find soft spots in our cigars. We pack our cigars. We use the amount of tobacco that is meant for that vitola. We weigh every single cigar. We draw test every single cigar. It's not a random testing. No, everything gets weighed. Everything gets draw tested. We try to provide as best of a quality cigar for the price that we're giving. You know, and that goes a lot into why they smoke longer, because we put a lot of tobacco into these cigars, trying to keep the draw open. But if you notice, our cigars do have a slight restriction on the draw.
Which I love. I love when they do that.
I don't like fully open cigars that you're smoking air. It's like you're breathing. You need to have a little bit of restriction, and it helps to build up smoke, get more smoke in the mouth for flavor, and it gives you that longer smoke.
Just a comment, the Cigar Corner guys next door watching the show are giving, looks like a thumbs up we got from James there. Great cigars. You get a chance to get your hands on one, you'll love it. So very good feedback already.
Trying to get it in as many hands as possible. We have some great reps out there. They're doing everything possible to get them into the stores, do tastings a minute that get them into the stores, and I'm doing everything possible. As far as marketing, it's a small company. It's hard for us to put money into marketing and into magazines, stuff like that. I enjoy doing this type of marketing and joining you guys and the appreciation that I personally have. I've expressed it to you before, Will. The appreciation I have for you guys that you guys don't make money doing this. This is a hobby that's turned into a passion for you guys. And the way that you have taken your personal time away from your families and everything to do this type of thing for the cigar community is admirable. It's truly admirable. And I truly, everything that I can to get the cigars into the hands, I try to do for our consumer. And you guys are a huge advocate for that.
Yeah, I will say, Gabriel, you know, Will and I don't do this full time. Yeah. But one of the great rewards that we get is finding these different brands that really impress us. And Flor de Silva is one of those brands that every cigar that you've sent me, every cigar that Will has sent me in the Flor de Silva line has really impressed me, and they've rated so well. And, you know, using our media presence to be able to promote brands such as yourselves is really rewarding because, like you said, you're a small company. But you're making an awesome product, and you know, we certainly appreciate that.
Like I said, I appreciate everything you guys do on your own time.
Yeah, well, and, you know, part of it, too, is I get to sit here and have a nice drink and have a cigar. And you know, that's a benefit as well. So,
yeah. No, I mean, it's there's a lot of brands out there. Mm. And, you know, Gabriel, you had a shop beforehand. And, you know, there's not a lot we could put at what you're saying, you know, what Maya Silva's doing right now. So, I know it's a long road, but the cigars are going to speak for themselves. This is a great product.
Now, Gabriel, like, kind of where are you at? I know there's a lot of people listening to this segment and listening to how much Will and I appreciate the Flor de Selva cigars. In the U.S., where can people find the cigars, and how are you doing with distribution in the U.S.?
The distribution is handled directly by us. We have our offices and warehousing here in South Florida.
Mm-hmm.
We have reps in some of the key markets so far, and I'm trying to expand. I'm trying to get some reps in the Northeast. Right now I'm handling that territory myself. Into the middle of the United States, the mid-north, Chicago, that area, we need a rep up there now. We have Texas. We have the Phoenix covered. We have the East Coast covered. And the Jersey, Philly area, we have that covered with another rep. In Florida, I'm handling myself as well as the other gaps that we don't have coverage in so far. Whenever I can, I get out there and I travel for just about a week at a time to visit stores. But we're starting to grow. We're in just over 100 retail locations nationwide, mm-hmm. and grow each week. We are averaging about one a week that we're opening up a new store.
Mm, good for you.
And it's just... it's tough because there's a lot of stores out there, and this is a huge country. And the fact that we have one distribution center, I'm one person, I can only handle the phones for so long a day, visiting stores locally, and whenever I'm in another territory with my reps are out there hustling. And we deal with brokers, so they don't only offer our lines, they offer other lines.
Mm.
So little by little, we're growing. And we're trying to get to the cigars into everybody's hands that we can at the time. Any store that wants samples, that just reach out to us. We're everywhere. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. We have our website with all our contact information, mayaselvacigars.com. Anybody. We do contests on social media all the time to get it straight into the consumer's hands.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, we're doing a huge contest on Instagram. Follow us on Instagram, Maya Selva Cigars. And we're doing an advent calendar. Every day we're giving something away to the 25th. One random winner gets picked from everybody that follows. Just follow the rules, like our pages, and you have a chance to win our cigars if they're not available in your area. And then we've selected key stores, small mom and pops, and a couple of the bigger guys to carry our cigars online. And we're about to start an exclusive catalog deal with Thompson that in January you'll be able to find Flor de Selva, Connecticut, and Maduro in the Thompson catalogs. It's a slow process because I don't want to oversaturate any particular area. We like giving exclusivity to the people that are giving us the love and helping us grow. So it doesn't do me any good to oversaturate an area where that retailer that's giving us the love and helping us grow doesn't feel that love back from us. They have plenty of choices to fill their shelves with.
Mm.
And I think it's the only way that I can, as a company, give that love to them. You know, a minimum of about 5 to 10 miles, depending on how big of an area it is, without anybody else around them that carries our cigars, to help it grow in that market.
No, that's excellent. I want to see more people, especially here in the Northeast, which I know a lot of people haven't been exposed to the brand, and we've been kind of ambassadors here in the local area. So I want to see more people say, "Oh, I've never heard of Flor de Selva," and then they smoke it and they're like, "Oh my God, where do I get these?" So I get that a lot, which is great.
Yeah, we have some great online retailers that ship nationwide. And like I said, we try to keep it as small of a retailer as possible to let them reach out a little bit more and help grow their business. You know, not just for us, but for the other brands that they do offer, where there's, and it gives the opportunity to anybody that doesn't have a retailer close to them that sells our cigars to be able to buy them. Mm. And just reach out to me via social media. Facebook, I accept just about anybody that's cigar related. I mean, there's their creeps and everything else, and they end up getting deleted soon after when I realize it. But I'm very selective because I'm so open on Facebook with my family life and everything else. Mm-hmm. I try to see, make sure we have mutual friends, people that smoke cigars, not just, you know, somebody trying to access all my information and all the people that follow me to follow them or look for girls or whatever it is, you know. But just reach out. And if you want to try our cigars, I will find a way for you to get a cigar in your hand.
Gabriel, what are the, you got quite a few different sizes, especially when we talk about the Flor de Selva line specifically. You know, how do you work with the retailer or distributor to choose which sizes they will carry?
Every area in the United States, and if the retailers we like to deal with are the type of retailers that, and one of my reps told me this, and I couldn't agree with him more, and there's two types of stores. There's the stores that sell cigars, and there's the stores that have cigars for sale. And the difference is that when you walk into a store and automatically you're greeted by whoever's behind the counter or whoever's in the humidor, mm-hmm. you know, hi, how are you? How can I help? Can I recommend something? Do you know what you're looking for? That type of store is where I like to be in, because I don't like to fall into a retailer where our cigars end up on a shelf. Nobody ever recommends them, because that's the only way we're going to grow. Our reps and myself, we can't be in every single carries our cigars all the time.
Right.
So we pick our retailers. It's almost like a hand picking. And as long as we see that there's a proactive approach to their clientele and there's good relationships between the clientele and the ownership or managerial staff or sales staff, we like to be in those stores. When the store is too big and they have thousands of facings in there, there's no guarantee in any store, but there's less of a guarantee that cigars are going to be successful in that store. So I like to pick the stores that will have a personal approach to every client that walks in through the store. And that's where I ran my store when I...
But, you know, having said that, Gabriel, you answered my question, right? If you're distributing to those stores know their clientele and which sizes, which wrappers that their clientele is going to like, and can make a more intelligent decision as to which ones from your line they're going to bring in. Because you have like over about a dozen or so different sizes. But the stores that know their clientele are going to know, hey, I know that our clientele likes 60 ring. And I know that they also have, you know, a whole bunch of Robusto smokers or whatever the case, you know, Maduro smokers versus Connecticut or whatever. They know that and can help you out better, and it'll be a better business relationship for you.
Exactly. And the other thing is that I don't deal with that whole minimum order type of situation that other manufacturers deal with. Yes, I understand. Is it worth to ship two boxes to a store and have them pay the shipping and everything else and have that margin reduced or added onto the cigar depending on the store, taxes depending on the area and everything else? I don't take that approach in forcing a store to carry a certain amount of cigars on my lines. No. I allow them to order what they think they can sell, and I'd rather have them call me every other week, tell me, Gabe, I need two more boxes. I need three more boxes, or to call my reps. We need two more boxes, three more boxes, five more boxes, 10 more boxes, whatever it is that they can sell, and they're not, you know, 100% fully invested into the cigars. People tell me sometimes in the industry, Gabe, but they're not investing into the product. There's no reason for them to push it, to move it. And I go, if I force them to bring in $2,000, $3,000 of cigars into their store, it doesn't guarantee me anything. It guarantees me that if they don't push the cigar themselves, I'm never going to hear from them again. That is a definite guarantee. But if the cigar works and my reps do their jobs correctly, which they're all doing a fabulous job, we get into a store and within 30 days we do a tasting. You know, as long as it fits the schedule of the store. If it's not within the 30 days, we always plan within that second month to do a tasting and get the cigar into people's hands. Mm-hmm. We don't do full-scale events and, oh, you get a free humidor when you buy a box of cigars. No. We do standard events, buy four, get one free, buy a box, get five free, that type of stuff, yes. And we never put that burden on the stores. We provide the free goods for that store. Because our goal is to get it into as many people's hands. Because we know once that cigar is in the consumer's hands, we have an 80% return rate on people liking our cigars right now. One guy that it doesn't fit their palate, and that's why they have the choices that they have. The variety. This is the best time for cigar smokers, I think, ever in our industry. Because the amount of great cigars that are coming out from all the other companies is incredible. Because everybody's trying to beat everybody into having quality, consistency, and great cigars.
Will, more questions for Gabriel?
Yeah. So, you know, actually, I just got a Facebook tag from Big Pete, and he was talking about one of your cigars, and I know a little about this cigar, maybe folks don't. There's the Florida Silva El Figurado, which was your exclusive to Underground Cigar Shop in Fort Worth.
That is one great cigar.
Now, that was from Europe, right? That was a cigar originally for the European market, and you had to give it another name here from what I understood, too.
Trademark issues. There's another company that the name of their company is the same name that we have for that Vitola. We tried straightening out the issue. We ended up having to change the name, we hushed everything off, and there was no harm, no foul type of thing. Right before we released the cigar, we renamed it El Figurado, and it was done. But that cigar is something that was released as a limited edition for the European market a while back, re-released for our 18th anniversary as a limited edition for that year. And it's just such a complex cigar. I want to say it's a medium-bodied Connecticut, full-flavored for a Connecticut wrapper cigar.
Is that the Perfecto size?
Yes. Yes.
And what store was that for?
For Underground Cigars in Texas.
Yeah,
so
Big Pete just gave me one. I haven't smoked it yet.
You gotta smoke that cigar.
I'm gonna smoke it in the morning. I didn't want to lit up now because I'm like 4+ cigars in for the day, but
get it on a fresh palate.
Yeah.
Coffee's great with it. For sure. And no, you're gonna talking about the complexity on that cigar is amazing.
Nice.
Now, with the strategy you did with Underground Cigar Shop, is that kind of something you might look at with other shops? You know, maybe because you have some really interesting sizes over in the European market in that line.
It's something that was easy for me to do because of the fact that that's a cigar that we were doing a small production for a store in Germany, and we just expanded that production for Underground to do. And it's definitely something that I'm willing to do with key partners throughout the States. With Underground, they've supported us basically from day one. They carry our lines, they promote our lines, they give us the love. And it's just something that felt right to do with them for their market. They have such a great following through their Facebook group and their locals that come in. There's people that travel from out of state just to go to their store. Whenever they do they had their first anniversary party last year, and it was incredible, the following and the amount of people that came from California into Texas, Phoenix, some people from the East Coast, from Georgia, I saw them in Texas, that they went just for that event. The following that they have is incredible. The love that they have for their clientele is second to none. It's a beautiful relationship that they have with their clients. Every day that one of their members on their Facebook group is celebrating a birthday, the ownership goes above and beyond, and they wish everybody a happy birthday individually. And it's a beautiful thing. Beautiful.
Yeah, I even got one of those birthday greetings. I got stranded in Dallas area back in February, and I happened, because I couldn't get out of the city, I happened to be stuck there for a few days, and I wandered into Underground. And everything you said is 100% true, including how they support your line, because I went in there, and they were showcasing pretty, you know, the stuff they bring in, they're going to showcase and they're going to get behind.
Definitely. They're a big boutique, very boutique-friendly store. They don't really carry the big names. And when they get behind the line is because they truly love it. They feel strongly about it, and they do stand behind their lines, and they promote them. And they don't promote one more than the other. It's every day it's a different line, and they truly get behind manufacturers that support their store with their following.
Yep.
They truly do.
And they're ball busters, too, and I like that.
They're fun. They're a fun bunch.
They're a fun bunch, really. And I mean that in a good way, that they're ball busters. Because that's where I grew up, that was a sign of respect. So that's all good. Yeah.
Sorry, I'm laughing. Our executive producer Keith is just making old fashions like at a clip that it's a pretty fast pace. I've watched probably four old fashions go by since we started this segment. I don't know who's drinking them.
The corner guys must be really. I saw a couple of glasses from the corner guys.
I got a refresh on my old fashioned. That was one. There's a lot more that are flowing throughout the studio here. So it's very much. I approve.
Yeah, Gabriel, we have a group of guys from a Facebook group, Cigar Corner, and they're in the viewing area next door.
Oh, awesome! Awesome. Yeah. Add me to the group. I love all those groups.
Yes, we'll send you an invitation, Gabriel. Yeah,
they don't force you. What do I love about them is they won't just add you. They you know, if someone wants to get in, they'll let them in, and I like that.
Let's see. Do we want to move to giveaways now, Will?
Do we want to move to giveaways? Yes. Do we want to do some of the giveaways?
You posted a picture on Facebook, Will, and there's a lot of great stuff we have to give away. And again, Gabriel, I want to thank you for sending us cigars. What Will had sent me, I thought was part of the giveaways, and Will's like, no, that's like what you have to review and smoke and share with your local community here, which is great because we have groups like Cigar Corner and you know other trusted people that we share cigars with. So we're putting your cigars in hands of people that we trust, which is great, and we have a whole ton of cigars to give to other people as well.
Yes, we do.
So what are we going to do for contests, Will? I haven't thought about...
Let me tell you what we have first.
Okay.
And again, this is very much thanks to Gabriel. Is we have two boxes of what we just talked about earlier. The Florida Silva number 14. Number 15, I'm sorry.
Is that Toro?
That is the Torpedo, the Bellicoso.
The Bellicoso.
Yep. So we have two boxes of those.
Both Maduro or
natural?
Natural, both natural.
Both natural, and then we have a couple of Maya Silver Zycar cutters. Really nice cutters. I don't know if you could see them, but so we could do. How do we want to do? We want to do four questions, or do we want to do two and two? How do you want to do it, Paul?
So we have two boxes. Are you going to give away the full box to someone, or what are you going to do, Will?
We're going
to
give away the full box.
And you have two boxes.
We have two boxes.
Okay.
So we have two cutters.
And two. I would give the cutter away with the box and do two contests.
You all right with that, Gabriel?
Fine with that.
Okay. So we have two boxes and two cutters.
So we need two questions.
All right. I got one already.
Okay.
And this one's easy. So we're giving away a number 15. What's the number 15 mean? Why was the number 15 picked for this?
Send the answer to the show at stogiegeeks.com. And it's what? First in?
We'll do this one as a first in.
Do this maybe. One as a first in, yeah.
And then we'll do the second one as a random.
Yeah, okay. I like that. So the first contest question, send the correct answer to the show at stogiegeeks.com. The first correct answer will be the winner of a box of number 15 Flor de Silva cigars in the natural wrapper. And that is, what does the 15 mean? What does that mean? What does that signify?
Yep. And yeah, we know it's the Vitola name, but you got to say why that was picked for the Vitola name.
Yep. The second question is, and this one this one's not first in. The second question for the second box of the same cigar with the cutter. This is a random one. So, you know, if you're listening to this live, if you're listening to watching the video, if you're listening to the audio, which all tend to be staggered, right? Obviously, live is the most recent one. The video usually comes out next, and then the audio is posted. So we'll give it a couple of weeks before we pick a random winner for the second box.
Do it for Christmas.
Yeah. This is the Christmas giveaway. I like that.
Yep, the Christmas giveaway.
Other than Honduran tobacco, what is the other type of tobacco in the Flor de Silva?
Maduro.
In the Flor de Silva Maduro. Yes. What is the other tobacco? The guys from Cigar Corner are like, they're in the studio and they're like raising their hand and they're waving their hands.
Specific. I don't know just where it's from, what kind.
What? Yeah, where it's from and what kind. What kind? Thank you, Gabriel. Yep. I like that. Send the answer to the show at SugiGeeks.com and you win a box of cigars and a cutter. And a box of really nice cigars.
Really? And by the way, I gotta make it up. Yeah, these are the new packaging on the boxes, which is stunning. This packaging, you did a great job with the packaging.
What's that, Gabriel?
I think that's the old packaging.
This is the old packaging?
Yeah, that's the old packaging.
Wow, it's still stunning. You're right, it's the old logo. You're right, it is.
It's like more squared up.
But the you're right. I apologize. Oh, it's still stunning. New-
That's a great giveaway. That's a great great incentive to listen to the Stogie Geeks and smoke Flor de Silva.
Yeah.
They're aged for over a year.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Private stuff.
Nice. Stogie Geeks staff do not qualify for the giveaways, unfortunately.
No. Sorry.
Sorry. Executive producers.
There's plenty of cigars.
That's right. That's right. There's plenty of cigars. You have two contests, and the members of Cigar Corner, which are probably furiously trying to submit their entries. A couple of the guys already got some.
They are eligible. Yep.
They are eligible. They also already got some as well. So they're probably more eager to win a full box of them because they probably really like them, which is the feedback we've gotten so far. So.
Yeah, and we have some tough customers. So it's good.
That's good.
Yep.
Awesome. That's the goal.
How are we doing on time? Do we want Gabriel to answer our new five questions, Will?
I love to do that. I would love you to do that. We have the new five questions. Yeah.
Gabriel, you have the honor. Now, here's the thing. We've been doing this on Stogie Geeks for quite some time. I've been doing internet TV and podcasting for about 10 years now. Several years ago, we started asking our guests questions. Over time, we settled on five questions to ask our guests. You've answered the original five questions already on the Stogie Geek Show. What I've come up with lately is a new set of five questions for guests that have been on the show before. So you are, in fact, the first Stogie Geeks guest to answer the new five questions.
Wonderful.
Are you ready?
I'm ready. I'm
You're
ready.
Never Hold truly on. Ready. You're as ready as you'll ever be, right? The first question, Gabriel, what is one thing that most people don't know about you?
One thing that most people don't know about.
Now, I'm going to give you time to think about this. I'm going to explain where this question came from. And Will doesn't know this yet because I haven't disclosed this yet. And actually, Will, this is a different question that I proposed before. But my wife went to a Christmas party last night. And she said before I went to the Christmas party, she was like, I had to write down the answer to this question. And everyone had to submit their answer. And then they had to guess which person had submitted that answer. And my wife's answer to the question was that when she's driving on the road and she sees someone who's like walking or like doing yard work on the road, she'll beep. She'll honk the horn like four or five times at this person so that they like jump up and wave. And that's what she does. So like we'll be in the family like driving somewhere and my wife will spot someone and she'll just start beeping at some random stranger and wave at them.
Nice.
That's how my wife rolls. It makes car rides with my wife pretty entertaining. My kids and I actually very much appreciate my wife's willingness to just beep at random people on the road. It's pretty funny. Her coworkers did not expect that she would do that. But to us,
we have a lot in common actually.
To the people, you know, my wife and my kids, like that's just the norm. Like we know that when my wife's driving. She's just going to beep at random people, and that's how she – and my kids love it. My oldest son is 7. My younger one is 2.5. They laugh hysterically, as do I, when she does that. So that's one thing that people don't know about my wife. So that's where this question comes from, Gabriel.
All right. We'll keep it cigar-related.
Okay.
Something that most people don't know about me, and it's going to be a two-part answer. One – I'm Cuban heritage. I was born here in the States. But both my grandparents on my mother's side actually worked in the cigar industry in Cuba in their younger years before the Castro regime took over.
Interesting.
That's a good one. I didn't know. That is a good one.
So, Gabriel, question number two is music related. And we're still kind of like testing the waters with this question, so bear with me. I want you to choose a song that, in your opinion, best represents one of the following. It can be A, a song that best represents your life. It can be B, one that you would play to get pumped up. Or it can be C, the best breakup song, in your opinion.
Best breakup song, in my opinion, would have to be that song by CeeLo, Fuck You, if I'm allowed to.
No, that's fine. That's fine. Hey, that's the appropriate. There's no right or wrong. That's fine. We're not regulated by the FCC, so.
No, that's all good.
No, that's good. That's good. Excellent. The you know where that question came from? I was in the shower, and Separate Ways by Journey came on my playlist, and I was singing it in the shower, and I'm like, that's the best breakup song ever, in my opinion. So we should make that a question.
There you go.
Number three, as most people know, the popular game of Ask Grabby Grabby is played in teams of three. Choose two people other than yourself to represent your team in the popular game of Ask Grabby Grabby.
First, you got to explain to me what this Ask Grabby Grabby game is.
It's popular in Europe, and it involves grabbing asses. As
and either grab it first, either one person has to go choose to go first.
First
or second.
Second, right? That was the original question. So now you have to field the team. If you're to field the team to play Ask Grabby Grabby, who's going to be in your team? Two people.
All right, two people to play Ask Grabby, and this is grabbing each other's ass or just random asses?
It's pretty much random, but not necessarily people on your own team.
Interesting. I'd pick Will because it would be funny to see him try to grab somebody's ass.
That's a good point. It's a good point.
I know I'm going to be picked a lot in this one.
and just a funny character in life, and one of my dearest friends, Jack Taranio.
That, you know, if I had to field the team of Ask Grabby Grabby, I think Jack Taranio would be – I would want him on my team as well.
He'd be a first-round draft pick. Yeah.
That's
a person of in size can grab somebody's ass and they'll turn around and be like, oh, sorry, yeah, okay. They'll turn around and leave.
I would choose Jack, and I would probably choose my wife, because if I'm going to be playing Ask Grabby Grabby, I'd want her on my team.
Well, the thing is, I don't want somebody to turn around and grab my wife's ass. That's the only reason I didn't say
well,
it.
Well, that's true. I guess, right. Yeah, depending on the rules. Whether you're playing European rules or American rules, that depends. So question number four, if you could have dinner with one person other than those you chose to be your parents, who would it be and why, alive or dead, fiction or nonfiction? Who do you want to have dinner with?
I'd like to say Yoda, but the conversation would be very limited.
True. Very true. It's a good choice, though. Very timely new Star Wars movie coming out next week, December 18th.
But I would honestly say Frank Sinatra.
Good choice. Good
choice. That's one lefty guy.
That's, and I guarantee we're gonna be doing a Frank segment in the next one too. Yep, that's.
There's got to be some great stories.
Yep.
Absolutely. Question number five: outside of your career that you've chosen and performed today, or the career that chose you, if you could choose anything outside of your current career, what would be your fantasy career, job, or career?
I wouldn't say fantasy, but I used to be in the construction industry, in residential construction. I used to build custom homes for families, for people. I would honestly say I would love to go back to that. The sense of satisfaction when you finish somebody's house and they move in and they live and they make it a home, seeing them enjoy that, it's just amazing.
Mm. Very cool. Gabriel, thank you very much for appearing on the Stogie Geek Show. Got some great contests out there. And I encourage everyone to try Flor de Silva cigars. We're very much enjoying the samples, that the latest round of samples that you sent us. We very much enjoyed the previous round that you sent us. So thank you very much for coming back on the show.
Yep.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. All right, Gabriel. Take care.
Tell Grace we said hello.
Yep.
Will do. Will do. Have a great night and Merry Christmas.
You too. Merry Christmas. And with that, we're going to take a short break, come back, and do our Debonair Ideal segment for this evening. So stay tuned. Don't go anywhere.